Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable. Say,
nothing shall be impossible.
Say,
your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore.
Jesus,
Jesus, our God, unstoppable.
Here we go.
Nothing shall be impossible. Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore.
Jesus,
Jesus, our God, unstoppable.
So we gonna sing it loud. We gonna shout it out. Hey, 'cause we know without a doubt that our God's unstoppable. We gonna sing it loud. Yes, sir. We gonna shout it out. 'Cause we know without a doubt that our God's unstoppable.
We're gonna sing it loud. We're gonna shout it out.
Louder.
'Cause we know without
a
doubt.
Here we go. Our God.
Our God's unstoppable.
Praise the Lord, the people of God, both in-person worship and those who are viewing by way of virtual means, we welcome you to the Pleasant Hill Baptist Church of Shreveport, Louisiana. Worship and praise as our Winds of Judah, under direction of Dr. Sonia D. Hester, accompanied by the Sons of Thunder, will come momentarily to lead us into worship and praise. Our deacons will render devotion. We will return momentarily to bring to you the bread of life. Come on and worship with me these next few moments that we have together.
For tomorrow,
hey.
morning. Our scripture. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith unto this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. For when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. But God commended his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Romans 5th chapter 1, 2, 6, and 8.
Good morning, my brothers and sisters. Let us go to God in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, which is in heaven, we come through our Son, Christ Jesus. We come thanking you once again for last night's rest. We thank you, Father, for allowing us to arise this morning in our right mind and a portion of help. Father, we ask that you look down from heaven on all that have come, those that are listening and those that have other means of viewing this broadcast. But most of all, Father, we ask that that word fall on their heart like rich soil. Father, we ask that the fruit come forth and that we learn that word and we put it within our heart deeply. Father, we pray for our brothers and sisters. We pray for all those that protect this country. We pray for all our citizens throughout this world. Father, we ask for that brotherly love that you have, for we know that you are love. Nothing you do is void. And Father, we ask that we search our heart and that we come to love each other and respect each other. Father, we ask that you look into the highways and the byways. We ask that you look down the sick, the bereaved. We ask that you look down the shepherd of this house, that you may feel his head anoint him, that he may flow with words of wisdom into our ears. Father, when it comes to that time, we must search ourselves and examine ourselves, that we must study war no more. But we look to the hill from which comes our help. We thank thee, we praise thee, the only true living God. This is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Somebody's healer.
Healer.
You. if he's made a way out of no way, if he's been good to you, give him some praise right then. Just think about how far he's brought us from. Just think about how he's provided food, clothes, and shelter. Just praise him for his goodness. Praise him for his goodness. Praise him for his goodness. For being a company keeper. For being a mind regulator. For being a provider. Praise him for his goodness. Oh, we thank you, God. We thank you, Lord. Nobody but you. You're worthy of all of the praise and all of the glory. It all belongs to you. And we just want to pause right now and say thank you. You've been so good. You've been so kind. You've been Jehovah Jireh. You've been our provider. You've been our battle axe. You've been our King of Kings and our Lord of Lords. You provided food, clothes, and shelter. You kept us from danger, seen and unseen. You comforted us when there were tears flowing. You just made a way, way after way, when we messed up and walked away from you. You gave us chance after chance to get it right. And we just thank you. Thank you. And we thank you, Lord. We thank you and give you glory. We thank you right now. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. At this time, we're going to hear a word, a rhema word from our pastor, Dr. Henry L. Armington, Sr.
I want to call your attention today from the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 9, and verse number 11. There you will find these words recorded in the Holy Bible, the King James Version edition of it, or perhaps on the screen for your reading pleasure. And the word of God reads, I returned and saw under the sun that the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, neither yet bread to the wise, nor yet riches to men of understanding, nor yet favor to men of skill, but time and chance happeneth to them all. Through the influence of the Holy Spirit and the challenges of life experiences, for these next few moments that we have together, I want to talk about what to remember when racing to the finishing line. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. What to remember when racing to the finishing line. Thank you, ushers. Thank you, musicians. If you would close the door a little for me. Thank you. Mark Twain once stated, as the greatest humanist produced by the United States of America, that the two most important days in your life are the day you were born and the day you find out why. My brothers and my sisters, it's imperative to know and believe that we have more positive influence in us than we perhaps have negative forces pushing against us. However, in every phase, in every facet of life, each of us are bound to encounter a great bundle of crises, circumstances, and catastrophes every now and then. The life of a true Christian believer, I have you to know today, unfortunately, is not an easy one. If the Bible promises us anything at all, it promises us that the way of faith is a struggle. And the reason why it's a struggle is because the world opposes to our allegiance to our God. The devil and his hosts of fallen spirits are literally warring and conspiring against us to try to persuade us to get out the race and to leave the track. But beloved, I don't believe the Lord we serve would risk his popularity to bring all of us believers out here in this wilderness this far and then just leave us. I don't believe the Lord has brought us this far to leave us. We are reminded through the scripture that without the full armor of God on, we are not going to be able to stand when the days become difficult. I have you to know that personal strength alone, numerous dedicated hours at the gym, and good eating habits for proper nutrition might cause you to lose a few pounds, but it won't help you gain poise. And that's why I believe the preacher in the text, the preacher in Ecclesiastes, says without any reservation that the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, neither yet bread to the wise, nor yet riches to men of understanding, nor yet favor to men of skill, but time and chance happeneth to us all. In other words, you win some and you lose some. But regardless if you are winning or losing, keep shuffling your feet. So I want to give you 3 points to remember when trying your hardest to make it to the finishing line. That's if you want to make it successfully and efficiently. First, if you want to make it to the finishing line, first you must remember to be, number one, goal-centered. Oh yes, you got to be goal-centered if you want to make it to the finishing line in this race of life. We're not alone in our struggle against sin and darkness.
We're not alone because Jesus Christ is both with us and he's inside of us by way of his Holy Spirit to see us through. No weapon formed against us shall prosper. He's inside of us. He's with us and he's inside of us. And as long as we keep our focus on him, we will make it to the finishing line. I know your body is aching. I know you get tired sometime. I know you have to experience a few cramps every now and then, but just refocus. Refocus on him who called you out of darkness to this marvelous light to participate in this race. And if you refocus on him, you can make it to the finishing line. You see, Jesus is the secret of my life. He's the lifter of my faith. He's the joy of my salvation. And in him I find not only strength to get me through a day, but I got power to overcome the day. And without him, it's impossible to make the goal of completing this race. I know you thought you could complete the race because you've been around the track field a few times and you've seen other folk run, but without Jesus, you cannot make the race successfully and efficiently. There's a song with the pen words to it. It says, I've been running for Jesus a long time, and I'm not tired yet. Why am I not tired? Because I am goal-centered. I see the finishing line, and I have a goal to make it through. Not only must you remember to be goal-centered, but secondly, you must remember to be, number two, godly connected. I got to be goal-centered, but secondly, I got to be godly connected. Listen, as your circumstance become larger in width and lower in depth, you're going to need to stay connected to God. Because there are some things in life God allows us to get ourselves in, but he has to get us out. And the only way you can get out is because you are connected to him. When you are in the race and connected to God, regardless of the sounds in the crowd, when you're connected to God, you can keep running. And at the same time, you can keep it moving. I have you to know that not all times is it about winning. Sometimes it's just about finishing. Sometimes we're so concerned about winning that we lose. But if I can just finish this race, everything is going to be all right. In this race of life, as a Christian, this is the only race you can enter where everybody can be a winner if they just finish. You know, normally in a race, you have first, second, and third place. But in this race, if I can just finish, I'm still a winner. But I got to be goal-centered and godly connected to do it. So I encourage you to rejoice today. Because after all you've been through, God still has you on his team. If the truth was really told, you and I, we should have been kicked off the team a long time ago. I mean, you miss practice. You came to the meet, but you were late getting there. You and I should have been kicked off the team a long time ago, but thanks be to God, He had enough mercy. He had enough mercy and love for us to allow us to just remain on the team. Why? Because we are connected to God. Listen, with over 500,000 lives lost to one single virus within the last 12 months, and look at you, you still here. With frozen turbines and oil and gas and transportation infrastructure catastrophes, you're still here. With residents just a few days ago, just a few weeks ago, just a few hours ago, struggling for food security, scrambling for sites of water distribution, stricken by electricity failure, could have froze to death, and you still here. With the White House FEMA department attempting to move from destruction to reconstruction in the greatest nation in our world. And yet, my brothers and my sisters, you are still here. Some of you, the week of the Arctic blast, had more money at the end of the week for that week than you've had in your possession at the end of a week in a long time. Thank God for the Arctic blast. You didn't have to live from week to week. You had some overflow. You are still here. You see, when we were born, I'm talking about when God created us, when we were given life. This life, according to the Bible, was like a race. And life, like a race, has a challenging course. Oh, yes, in other words, it has its ups and downs. It has its highs and lows. It has its hills and curves. But in order to get to the finishing line, the runner must be goal-centered and godly connected. And as long as I'm goal-centered and godly connected, I can make it to the finishing line. Not only must you remember to be goal-centered, and not only must you remember to be godly connected, but thirdly, if you want to make it to the finishing line, you must remember to be, number three, gracefully changed. I told you a few moments ago, we don't even deserve to still be on the team, but thanks be to God's grace, giving us something that we really didn't deserve, and keeping some stuff from us that we did. We should have gotten the beat down a long time ago, but thanks be to God's grace. I'm told that a runner, in preparation for a new race, goes through weeks of conditioning. They beat their body up. They pain their body. They ache their body on purpose. So on meeting day, to participate in the race, they can perhaps not only finish, but win. You and I, we're in this race. We're in this race called life, and you must be changed. You must be changed physically. You must be changed mentally. You must be changed spiritually. Now, from the world's perspective, winning is based upon speed, strength, intelligence, and wealth. From the world's perspective. From the world's perspective, my brothers and my sisters, if you want to win, you got to have speed. You got to have strength. You got to have intelligence, and you got to have wealth. You don't believe it? The word of God in Ecclesiastes chapter 9 verse 11, it says, the race is not to the swift that speed, nor the battle to the strong that's strength, neither yet bread to the wise that's intelligence, nor yet riches to men of understanding, nor yet favor to men of skill, that's wealth. And so according to the world, from the world's perspective, if you want to be a winner, you got to have speed, strength, intelligence, and wealth. However, from God's perspective, winning is based upon pleasing Him and Him only. Somebody should have shouted right there. Winning, if I want to win, when I'm on God's side, I don't have to have speed, I don't have to have strength, I don't have to have intelligence, I don't have to have wealth. All I need to do is please Him and Him only. I think I need to tell you that we have not earned the right to do less than our best. Because only when we do our best, we do it to please and satisfy the Father. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart, as working for the Lord and not working for men. You see, you would never please men all the time. You please them today, they mad at you before tomorrow. But the more you work at pleasing God, the more you will discover that God is working to please you. The more I do for Him. Now, I'm not doing it for Him to get anything. I'm just doing it for Him because it's the right thing to do. But hey, just for favor, God rewards those who aim to please Him and to satisfy Him wholeheartedly. That's with the right motive. You see, just because you give me $100 doesn't necessarily mean you gave it with the right motive. You may want something in return later on down the line. Then you're going to be sadly mistaken. When I told you, brother, I thought you were coming to give me another one. Sister, I thought you were getting ready to give me another one. I done already spent that one. But we have a bad case of helping those whom we assume can help us in return later on, as if it's a layaway plan. You know, put something on it now, come back and get it later. Oh, nobody in here have ever participated And everybody have always had that silver spoon in their mouth. I remember mama would start right after Christmas putting stuff on layaway for next Christmas. Those green stamps. Participating in that that sweepstake. Ain't never worn nothing, but we kept on participating in it. But if we just please God, God will reward us accordingly. You see, this old world, though I love fried chicken, fried shrimp, fish and grits. This old world, though I love Bluebell ice cream, milkshakes, Dairy Queen blizzards, root beer floats. This old world, though I love fancy houses, expensive automobiles, motorcycles, and designer clothes, I have you to know that this world is still not my home. I'm just a sojourner passing through. And the only way I can make it to the heavenly finishing line is by being gracefully changed to the one who established the race and set rules and regulations for it. And so, my brothers and my sisters, as I hurry to a close, must I hold you too long? We will forever become delinquent in being champions. In other words, we will never become a champion until we see ourselves as a champion. You must be motivated, comfortable enough in your own skin to live your life for God and work hard in serving Jesus. Because if the truth be told, we are children of the Most High God. We are related to the Creator. We are the belongings to a royal family. And so, beloved, let us jog alone. Let us do it with confidence. Let us marathon through. Let us do it with self-worth. Let us run knowing that we are a special people to the one who forgave us. We're special to the one who allowed us to participate in the race, that we may someday share and proclaim the good news. And by the grace of God, I am what I am because He was. I think I better say it one more time. I said, by the grace of God, I am that I am because He was. He being Jesus, the Son of God, He was spat upon. He was slapped around. He was humiliated. But he kept on racing to the finishing line. He was beaten until his skin was broken into little fragmented pieces. But he kept on racing to the finishing line. He was brutally murdered on a hill called Calvary. But he kept on racing to the finishing line. And I heard him say, right before he gave up the ghost, he said, it is finished. I heard him in the word of God when he said, it's done. And so, beloved, when you get down to your own Red Sea, knowing that you got one more river to cross, it's not time to drop your rod. When you get down to your own Red Sea, knowing that you got one more river to cross, it's not a good time to pull off your armor. When you get down to your own Red Sea, knowing you got one more river to cross, it's not a good time, yes, to lose faith in God. But just remember to be goal-centered. Just remember to be godly connected. Just remember to be gracefully changed. Even if you're unable to articulate your thoughts, even if you're unable to speak your command, just remember this one thing: if God brought you to it, he sure enough will carry you through it. Just hold on to the hand of God. God is with you, and he will deliver you on time. Keep racing with all your confidence. Keep racing with your right motivation. Keep racing to turn your setbacks into comebacks. That's what Jesus did when he had given up the ghost. He died on a hill called Calvary. They took him down. They buried him in a borrowed tomb. He stayed in the grave all night Friday. He stayed in the grave all day Saturday. He stayed in the grave all night Saturday. But early Sunday morning, it was the third day, he got up out of the grave with all power in the heaven and earth. And beneath the earth, he had it in his possession. And he still has the same power to give you strength, to give you power to run this race. So you won't have to run this race in vain. And so if you can't run, keep on jogging. If you can't jog, keep on walking. If you can't walk, you sure enough ought to crawl. If you can't crawl, just stretch forth and scoot yourself. Stretch forth, grab God's hand and scoot yourself until you finish making this race. Because this race is not given to the swift. This race is not given to the strong. But if you hold out a little while longer, everything is gonna be all right.
Just remember Just remember to stay goal-centered. Just remember to be godly connected. Just remember to be gracefully changed. And in due time, God will work a miracle in your life. Don't have to worry about speed. You don't have to worry about strength. You don't have to worry about intelligence. You don't have to worry about wealth. But your main concern should be pleasing God and pleasing Him only. If you believe that, give the Lord a round of applause. Oh, bless His holy name. We thank God for those of you that are here in person worship, those who are viewing by way of virtual means. We extend the invitation to Christian discipleship to you right now. Perhaps you're out of the ark of safety. You've yet to accept Jesus as your Savior and make Him the Lord of your life. You've never confessed with your mouth. You never demonstrated publicly that you believed in your heart that Jesus is the Son of God and that He died for your sins. He died for your wrongdoings. If you truly believe it, you can come now and make that open and public profession. Or perhaps you're viewing by way of virtual means. You can call us at the number that will be listed on the screen momentarily. And we want to minister to you and then direct you to a church and the locale of your vicinity that's nearest you so you can work out your own soul salvation with fear and trembling where the word of God is both being taught and preached. So you can get involved in what we call kingdom building, working for the master, demonstrating that you are desiring to please Him, to please Him with your worship, to please Him with your praise, to please Him with your service. So one day, when Jesus returns, you'll be able to go home to your eternal home with Him. He'll introduce you to God and He'll introduce you to God's angels. That'll be your eternal home. If you're here today, you can come by baptism, you can come by Christian experience, you can come by letter, meaning that you've already been baptized and you're in this vicinity and you want to become affiliated with this church body, you can come today. Just now, would you come?
We offer Christ to you, oh my brother. We offer Christ to you, oh my sister.
Certainly thank you for joining us during this moment of worship and praise, and we pray that you have received something from this experience that you've embarked upon this day. We pray that the message have been a blessing to you as it was to me presenting it to you. I want to ask that you would sow into this ministry. There'll be information that will be available on the screen for you. Our narrator, our moderator, controller,
facilitators will walk you through the process. And we pray that you would lend tithes and offering to God through this ministry and see what your return will be in the days to come. Those of you that are in person worship, as you exit the sanctuary, usher representatives will be available to receive your tithes and offering, any other donation you desire to sow into this ministry. We're so privileged that you have been with us this day, and we pray God's blessings upon you, that you will have a peaceful day, and God will reward you according to the work, the service that you've rendered unto him. Let's go to God in prayer. Gracious Master, we thank you this day for bringing us together, that we not forsake ourselves to assemble. So God, we bless your name for giving us this privilege, giving us this opportunity to come together again. We realize that you could have done away with us a long time ago, but you're still using us for the sake of your kingdom. And so God, we pray that you would protect us, shield us from all hurt, harm, and danger. We rebuke every demonic spirit, every scheme of the devil. We know that he's trying to rob us. We know that he's trying to steal us of our joy. But we're proclaiming today that you are the joy of our salvation. So we just come to worship you. God, we just came to your house to praise you. Those that are listening and viewing by way of virtual means, we pray a special blessing upon them. Bless everybody that's connected to them. And when it's all said and done, we won't try to rob you of any of your glory. We won't try to steal any of your praise. We won't try to tell folk what we've done, but we'll tell the world that it was nobody but you that worked a miracle. We thank you for increase. Thank you for food on the table, a roof over heads, clothes on backs, and sound mind, and a reasonable portion of health and strength. We thank you right now. And if we not get this opportunity again, God, we thank you for this day. For this is the day that you have made. And regardless what happens after we leave, we will rejoice and be glad in it. In Jesus' name, now unto him that is able to keep you from falling, present your faultless before his presence with exceeding joy. Only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forever. And all of the people of God said amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord until we meet again. Eulogia, be blessed, beloved.
Children, may his favor be upon you.